We all know Gareth Blakeslee from Lake Catherine. I mean, he's a very familiar face around town, for good reason.
And also good reasons.
And he's here tonight to talk about Edgelands, and I'll turn it over to you, Gareth.
Thank you very much. So this is kind of a strange topic that I've been kind of exploring over the last few years. I mean, one of the things I think about with Edgelands is they're kind of the lands that kind of go up against other lands. And I've been thinking about how most of the landscapes that we actually operate in and go through are really a kind of a crossover between true countryside, whatever that means, and urban areas. And we almost all live in that kind of juxtaposition of very rural and very urban. And these edges have been kind of fascinating me for a while, because I think about walking around Palos Heights and I see these little areas or places that you can actually see. And it's almost discovering like the natural world around you. And as much as anything, I feel this is a way of kind of connecting with nature by just exploring things that are very close to you as you're exploring. So I've been kind of thinking about this for a while. And so I was talking about how I can make this into a program and how to explain this. And I think I think Janine came up with the idea of like make it kind of a tour of around Chicago. So I'm putting the blame on her right now, actually.
Hey.
So explore Chicago, because Chicago has these wonderful little pockets of natural areas and not so natural areas, but they all deserve exploring for different reasons. And so it turned into that kind of area of like looking at Chicago, looking at Chicagoland, and see what you can find around those areas. But to put this in context, is like sometimes when you like going into a car park or a parking lot, and you'll see this natural area at the back of it, and it may be a bunch of weeds and maybe some like timothy hay and a variety of things, but it's buzzing with life because it's been forgotten. And there's like you can go into there, you see spiders feeding on crickets, feeding on grasshoppers, and there's lots of stuff going on. There's milkweed in which also we've been talking about milkweed a lot with the monarch butterfly. And sometimes these forgotten areas are actually a better way of encouraging wildlife, and maybe we should actually embrace these forgotten areas a little bit more than we should. I thought about this lovely phrase that is really terrible, actually. The interfacial interzone between urban and rural. Only a scientist could really come up with that kind of statement. But it really is. It's basically saying we're basically having rural areas kind of fighting against the urban areas all the time. This is good, you can't see me now. So this is why I was kind of throw it in there. But a lot of people come up with different names for that, which we'll go through a few of those as well. When I've been thinking about this, there's scientists have been talking about trying to use a term called the Anthropocene. And a lot of geologists don't like this term because it's not a technical term, but it has a lot of benefits to it. Basically, it's saying that we're now in the age where humans have affected everything on Earth in some form or another. Whether it's pollution with heavy metals or plastic in our oceans, whether it's pumping methane and carbon dioxide into our atmosphere, whether it's the thousands of years we've been doing agricultural areas since Mesopotamia started. So we've had an impact on everything. And because we travel all the way around the world, there is no place on the planet that, even though it's remote, is not impacted by us in some way. So people are saying that we should now say that we're actually entering the Anthropocene, the era which is affected by humans solely. And I think it's an important term to remember, even if geologists don't specifically like it, because it's very hard to pinpoint when they actually start and when that will actually end, or we'll never know when that ends. But I think it's a good term to actually kind of be aware of. And I think it has a good environmental message as well, to realize that maybe that's where we are right now. Maybe we do have an impact on absolutely everything. And acknowledging that, I think, is important. But some of the terms that people have been using are kind of fun for all these kind of like affected areas. One of the terms is feral lands, basically land that's been affected by humans, but now it's actually had been let to go wild. So if you find an empty lot that you have things growing in amongst it, that is a feral land. A nice term, bastard countryside, which is basically countryside that's grown up secondary to maybe an urbanized area. Edgelands, as we've heard. Novel ecosystem is actually a scientific term that scientists are actually using to say that you wouldn't actually change an ecosystem because it now actually has ecological merit, even if it isn't what it was before. Commons and verges are very common, like English sayings. Droscape I quite like as well, because it kind of implies it's kind of a not very nice location. But I think there's a beauty in some of these areas as well. But really, all it means is basically where city and countryside fray into each other. And I think the term that Robert McFarlane uses, fray, is a great term because it's really kind of like fragmenting and kind of piecing around into each other. And I think some of these areas also, especially in urban areas, they're very ephemeral. They don't last that long. You can go into this area and one day it might be an abandoned warehouse district with some common weeds growing up amongst it, and the next time it could be like a whole new housing development, and it's completely changed. So almost by nature, some of these areas are changed, and are changed constantly. The main benefit is, one of the things that we are seeing, though, is the restoration movement, and that movement going into Chicago has been a really huge help about bringing biodiversity into Chicago as well. But before we talk about Chicago, we should talk a little bit about why Chicago is here. Well, Chicago is here is because of its environment. The reason why humans came to this area is they decided this is a great portage through to the Illinois River and that we could have a lot of shipping coming through this area. And it's all because of our geography. Basically, this is the current shore of Lake Michigan right here. This is where Lake Chicago used to be. But Lake Chicago, this is basically a bigger Lake Michigan, used to drain through these outlets. We're at those outlets right now. So if you go down to the Cal Sag, that used to be the face of one of those outlets. And these are actually natural river courses that came through. You have the Chicago River that comes all the way down here. The Chicago River basically joined up with the natural portage into the Illinois River. And this is why Chicago exists. And so we came here because of the environment, because it was useful to us. We used the riverways. But you can also, by looking at this, you can see that this was a floodplain to begin with. That's why it's flat, basically, Chicago. And then you have Stony Island, which is the moraine that's over towards Blue Island. I beg your pardon, it's Blue Island. And then you also have the moraines that were to the west of us right here. Basically, all the hilly ground to the west of us is former moraines. So that's what's kind of creating our landscape in this area. But it has another impact because it basically developed some of the ideas for the burning plan and why some of those areas were kept green before coming through. So when I look at this plan, Burnham came up with these great architects, came up with these wonderful ideas of trying to incorporate green spaces with Olmsted into the city of Chicago. And basically it was used in the natural avenues that we'd already have here, and that also humans have modified. If you look at this, this is clearly a canal coming down here. This is the Palos Forest Preserves to our west right here. These are all waterways that are connecting. This is this plain's watershed right here. These are all the forest preserves that they created about 100 years ago so that they could actually create open spaces. And you know what? I keep saying that city needs lungs, and I can't remember who that's attributed to because I think it's Burnham, but I don't remember seeing any quote attributed to him saying that. So if anyone knows where that quote comes from, let me know now. but a city needs lungs is a really wonderful statement because it basically is saying that you need green space in urban areas to make us, one, as humans feel happier and live in a nice environment. It reduces violence, it actually does produce oxygen in the atmosphere, and also helps kind of reduce noise and all those other kind of benefits as well. So I really like that phrase. But Burnham is really instrumental in kind of creating those green spaces that we see in Chicago. Not just the forgotten ones, but the planned ones that we actually have. This is a green infrastructure vision of what Chicago could be and is in part right now. And as you can see, you've got all these wonderful forest preserves out to the west and how they kind of circle around the city. But we've also got the lake. The lake is a wonderful resource, which I'll talk about in a little bit as well. We have the park district areas that go along the side of the lake as well. But because of all these avenues, like the waterways into the city, that creates avenues for wildlife and nature to actually go into the city. And it connects everything. These corridors are vitally important for wildlife. And it's probably one of the reasons why Chicago is a very green city in general. So, I'm going to be going over, I kind of like exploring parts of the city and the suburbs, and one of my favorites, which I'll be talking about in a little bit, is Lake Michigan, right there where it intersects with the city, because there's very few places in the world where you have like a Great Lakes coming up against a metropolis like Chicago, and it's a beautiful skyline, and it's a beautiful lake, and it's fairly clean as well, which is also a nice thing. But we've got all these other wonderful things like dunes, waterways, the city itself, boulevards, the roadside verges, these empty allotments, the parkways, the parks, the forest preserves. Not many other city has all of these kind of combined together to make such a green space and a place where you can actually explore lots of different wildlife and see different wildlife. And it's been increasing over the years as well. It's not necessarily high quality, many of it, but it's also very interesting to see. So One of my favorite places to explore, and I recommend it, and people who know me are probably bored by me talking about this already, is this place called Morgan Shoals. It's one of the few natural reefs of Chicago, and you can swim to it, and it's great. You can actually swim out to a natural reef and snorkel on it, which I have done. And it's just about off 47th Street. There's a little kind of a very colorful toilet right there. I know that sounds very strange, but it's beautifully done. A lot of murals on the outside. And about that point, you can head out about 200 meters offshore in fairly clean water, and you can actually come onto this Dolomite Reef, which is fantastic. This is the Dolomite Limestone. This is the same limestone that you find just to the west of here, where Camp Sagawa goes through. This is basically the ancient seabed of a tropical ocean that doesn't exist any longer. You can actually go out onto that reef, swim along, snorkel along, and you can see the scratches from when the glaciers retreated back and forth across this Dolomite limestone. And this is all accessible in a quick swim. 200 meters is fairly decent. And you can go out there. What's really fun about this area, there's a wreck of the Silver Spray that you can actually go out to. And so if you want to have a little bit of a rest, you can actually sit on this wreck, and it seems like you're sitting on the lake, and no one knows how you're sitting on it. And it's amazing, you can go out there. I actually was lucky that this year I went out there two or three times, and the second time I went out there this year, I was actually went out on the anniversary of the Silver Spray sinking, which I thought was kind of, I don't know why that was the case, but it was, but I quite liked it. So the lake, I think, is really, really important, especially when you can explore it, because we always think about these battlements of like we're trying to prevent erosion along the way, but you can see in places where the lake is really kind of fighting back, it's really crumbling in those areas, and it almost looks natural as well. The other thing that they've been doing along the lake is Norbury Island, which I'll talk about in a second, is such a well done a kind of resource of where they're really trying to say, we're going to make a fisheries here. We're going to make a natural area to explore. And it's very well done. I've been out there a few times. It's never that busy. Once you get past a variety of like all the museums and stuff, like it's great to go and see. So this is just inland from where Morgan Shoals is. So it's literally, if you head off about 200 meters off water, you can actually go to the thing, go to the reef. What I like about this area, this is Chicago's only natural beach. That's actually formed naturally, it hasn't been augmented with any kind of sand or anything like that. And it's shingle, it's pebbles. And it's so incredibly clear, the water as well, so you can actually go out there. And there was just the last time I was down there, there was actually people from the shed who were actually drift netting along this area. They were looking for different types of fish as well. They were looking for dace, they were looking for a number of other things, and they were capturing things. So there's actually things going in around there because you've got a natural shoreline here, which is actually really cool. And also you've got the battlements here and the concrete girders to keep all the storm protection out. But you can hop down onto this beach and it's the clearest water that you've ever seen. This is almost tropical quality translucency. And that may be due to the zebra mussel as well. Sorry, zebra mussel. But that it's a really amazing place to visit. Norbury Island, this is one of the outlets that they actually created. This is at the southern end of Norbury Island. And right here is basically where they made it shallow enough where they can actually allow native fishes to come in and out of this outlet, so hopefully they'll spawn. And they made it shallow enough so they didn't have things like the Pacific salmon or other types of species that would actually kind of swim up and in here. So they're really trying to think about it. All this is native plants. So obviously this is all human-made. This is us trying to kind of recreate something, but that's why it's not a natural system. But we're trying to get close to something. So obviously, many of you may have remembered it as Migs Field, where one night Daly came in and put some bulldozer X's across the thing. I used to live downtown at the time, and we actually had a view of Migs Field, and it was kind of funny the next day, like, look at that, no more aircraft, okay. But what they've done since with it has been pretty amazing, so I really quite like that. So what you've got is like you've got this natural system that they've created. They're really thinking about that. Then you've got these natural shoals, actually, just a little bit further south than here. So if you could probably go about 20 blocks south. And you've got a couple of all these Dolomite limestones. If you go back to this, the Morgan Shoals area is actually known for a variety of different fish that you might actually find out there. So that's really exciting to actually know that there's not just things like brown gobies, which they actually is an invasive species, but they're actually finding that some of our lake poachers are starting to eat that, which is actually a good thing. But they actually will have bass on there. When I went out there last, there was actually bass swimming around the wreck that was out there. So there's things that are grown out there, perch as well. So So it was kind of nice to see that this natural area is right offshore. Around this area as well, again, I'm kind of focusing more on the south side here. I guess we're all southsiders here anyway. This area, this all looks completely natural to me, but this is all former barricades against the lake. And I love how basically the lake is taking this area back here. You've obviously had so much wave action going on here. This is turning into a natural beach right here. And you have a natural succession of plants that are coming in here. You have cottonwoods down here. Cottonwoods are usually kind of comes into an area near water. They like the water. We've got willows further in. And you've got things like bone set in here, and milkweed is starting to grow as well. And it's basically turning what we made to fight against the lake into an area that's actually becoming much more natural. And it's kind of a forgotten bit. It's just off like the Burnham restoration area down there. But I think this is a kind of a cool area to explore because you really feel the wildness of the lake kind of impacting Chicago. And if you left it for a little bit while. Yeah, go ahead.
Is this the northern island?
No, this is a little bit further south. Okay. So this is probably not quite, this is probably like a about 40th Street-ish around that area. It's near where they'll be doing the Burnham corridor. They're doing a lot of restoration work down there as well, but this is just off to the side there, where they've been putting a few new kind of art pieces along the way. But this wasn't done by humans, this was just done all natural. It's just broken up over time by the lake, which I think is pretty neat. What I also like about this is, I don't know if this looks familiar, but this is probably not a viewpoint that people normally think of as when they look at the Adler Planetarium. Looking from the south, looking north. And most of the beaches that are created around Chicago, they're not natural, but they've done a really good job over the past years of putting the marin grass in there, which is a successional species around areas in a natural area. And this almost looks natural. If you go to this picture, you wouldn't know that you're in Chicago right here. But here you are, looking out against Lake Michigan. I mean, it's just a different viewpoint from that, but it's still, this doesn't look like you're in downtown Chicago, only maybe a few minutes away from Grand Park in itself. And I love the fact that you can find these little areas where you really keep doing a lot of work into this area. And it's creating a natural structure. So eventually with the marin grass, it stabilizes the sand. You have other successional species. Succession is basically when you get grass, creates a bit more soil, then you have things like cottonwood, box elder start to come in. Other things start to get established as more soils develop, as the marin grass takes over. But I love that the fact that you can actually go around and explore areas and really be away from it in a city of 3 million people. One of the fun things I was able to do back in May is actually explore the Chicago River a little bit. And this is where my friend Charlotte and I went out there really early in the season. And this is right down there, Wharf Point is, where basically the start of Chicago actually started. And I know a lot of people are probably like, you don't want to go in the Chicago River. Now, I'm not sure I'd want to go swim in the Chicago River, but it's got a lot better, even since I've lived in the States now about 16 years, and I've seen so many changes over time, and it has improved. It doesn't smell, for one, which I think is a start. But even these things, the things that Charlotte's hanging on to are these floating natural waterways, where they actually take the nutrients out of the water into the native plants, so they're floating in. It's an amazing idea that they're actually using the urban scape to kind of take away some of the nutrients and kind of make it a little bit healthier. And I love the fact that these are kind of old piers to the left, and you still have grass and vegetation just kind of hanging on there with like big urban canyons basically around you. And it's such a great kind of setting to actually do that. And I know they're trying to improve the Chicago River over time, and it is improving as well. But these little things, I think, are really making a difference. And I know North Shore, that you have people living on and around the Chicago River as well, just because they had resources there. You can actually fish things, you can actually find things in the water. There's a recent article in the Chicago Magazine talking about it as well, which I think is fascinating. But, you know, this is a nightcrawler heron. This is a photo we took. It's not the best photo in the world, but this is a photo we took. This is a state-listed species, and it's found in the Chicago River. And, you know, one might argue whether it should be on a state list or not, but the fact is, you have a night-crowned heron found in the Chicago River, able to survive, and it's actually able to feed as well. They're finding things like muskrats, beavers, they're even talking about otters coming back to the area using our waterways as well. So there's an improvement in general of fish kind of coming back as well, just because of the quality, there isn't so much pollution in it as well. And clearly, this is a human-affected environment. This is not, but nature starts, nature comes back eventually, which I always find great as well. I mean, there's soft-shell turtles in this area as well. So if you ever have the chance, there's a great book called The Chicago River, A Natural and Unnatural History. And it talks all about how the riverways basically created this area that we live in. And the rivers were very, very important to creating this space. But it's a great read. But we shouldn't forget the other areas. The Canal Sag is right down our way. This was part of the second. This was part of a natural water body, right? The reason why they put the Canal Sag right here is because it was a natural waterway for this area, probably more marshland, and that's improving. I'm sure many of you have probably realized the aeration, the seeper stations that they put in, has actually helped aerate the lake. And I work at Lake Catherine, and now we're seeing all kingfishers. We're having bald eagles coming back into the area, and they wouldn't come back if there wasn't the habitat for them, or if there wasn't the environment for them. So I think that's a great thing. And, you know, obviously it's an unnatural environment, and you can tell that because it's so channelized. But these other areas, the Illinois Michigan Canal, it's also having things come back. So I think that's a really exciting thing. So the other thing about these canals that are really important and waterways is because there's vegetation, even if it's not high quality vegetation on either side, that creates corridors for wildlife to come in, that creates flyways for birds flying in, especially on the spring migration. And it creates these ways of animals being able to connect with other animals, which I think is very, very important. One of the things that's kind of fun is, you know, our city is an urban landscape. It's one of the most urban landscapes you can ever imagine. It's all basically cliffs and ravines. It's basically what it is to the natural world. But what I like about it is the fact that you can still find things like chicory and plantain and chickweed still kind of growing in the cracks around it. But it's not just that. You may have like started reading a little bit about, I mean, you've probably all seen that we have tons of pigeons here. And, you know, love them or loathe them. They live here because they originally come from the coppies of Africa, which are basically rocky outcrops, and they moved into the Mediterranean. And then they moved over to the States. So these pigeons have created, love the environments that we create for them because we provide food and we create nice rocky outcrops for them. Basically our buildings. But what likes it a lot is peregrine falcons. They love our environments. And because we stopped using as much pesticides, these peregrines are now starting to actually kind of, there's pairs of population peregrines. And if you ever are a bit more interested in seeing what's actually going on with these, there was recently a book by a lady from the Field Museum. But their populations are increasing because they love what we've created for them. They keep down pigeons, which I know some people don't like pigeons. My wife hates pigeons. She hates them more than rats because she's just scared. So she'll be like, pigeon, and then a peregrine come by and she's much happier. But it's a fascinating thing to actually think that we've actually created this environment, and a raptor that was once in decline because of pesticide use has now found a niche in our cities and is doing probably better in our cities than otherwise. You think about other animals that you might find in our urban areas. You've got raccoons, you've got possums, you've got all these other things that are actually living in these areas. Not maybe so much in the downtown canyons, but the things are out there.
Coyotes, they even hit those recently.
What's that, sorry?
Coyotes.
Absolutely, yeah. And it's partly because they can kind of come down and use these corridors to get to and from. And I think a few years ago there was a story about a coyote that was in a cooler in someone's, and the poor thing just kind of looks, what am I doing here? But you know, that's pretty cool. The other thing that's been great about Chicago, we're talking about all the Canal Sag and the Chicago River and then the lakefront, these are all corridors for wildlife. But because of the Chicago fire, we have our boulevards. They redesigned the area to have boulevards in certain locations, and they connected some of these parks, Douglas Park, Garfield Park, Humboldt Park, they all have these boulevards connecting, the Midway Plaisance further down. They all connect, they create this kind of ring area. And what that means is there's a potential for wildlife, sunny squirrels, other things, to go from one area to another in a semi-green space because it's a wider street from green area. I think there's potential for these areas to actually be better for recreating wildlife corridors because you can plant them with native plants. And I think some of them have been, but I think you can actually do it, like if you put some prairie plantings in some area. That's great for our insects as well. We talk about the monarch butterfly all the time, but there's other pollinator species that need help as well. And they all need like these resting spaces. So if you're a migrating bird, it means you've got places to stop off. And it's not just an urban track that you have to fly over, which is actually quite cool. The other things we don't think about sometimes is our roadways. I mean, we've seen red-tailed hawks numbers increase over the years as well. And they seem to love just to kind of fly back and forth. How many times when you go and say the Dan Ryan or somewhere, you'll occasionally see a hawk and a light pole. Cooper's Hawks are in our neighborhoods. Their numbers
are
increasing.
Maybe that's what it was. I was excited.
Yeah, no, it's always exciting. But the red tails love the roadways, especially, and so they seem to fly over there. And you know, we drive past there, but you'll see wildlife there because you know we planted some of these roadways. We don't always mow them down to the ground. We create a little bit of areas for them, and maybe it's because you know we don't have the budget to mow all these areas. But what it means is this natural landscape here that actually can be discovered. Now, I'm not saying that you should go down to our roads and wander along the roads, but it's good to look out when you're driving. Our Chicago rail lines are really interesting. They're, because most of the rail lines were built quite a long time ago, a lot of the air, and they like to keep down the woody vegetation around those areas. We've had lots of native vegetation remains along our railways. These are also natural capitals. This is actually on the metro line just going through Lake Catherine. You kind of go up around the corner. This is all native plants right here. This is a Virginia wild rye. There's a big blue stem up there, some Indian grass. There's a variety, rolled off a couple of other things as well. But the facts of the matter is these are native grasses here growing, and no one's doing that much from an actual active maintenance. They just happen to be there, and they've probably been there for quite a while. But it's a natural landscape again. You're creating these natural corridors, and you can find wildlife here because you've got some natural structure there, which is really exciting. And it looks cool as well with the greens. So these are great avenues and corridors for wildlife to come in and out of the city, and they're worth exploring as well. This is a kind of an allotment, well, I call it allotments. We've got friends who, they own Pleasant House Bakery, and they actually do a lot of their work at this place called The Plant, which is on the south side, and they do a lot of their little allotments right here, where they do some vegetables and stuff like that for their restaurant. What I love about this, look at all these other people that have done different things that work at this plant. It's basically a former meat packing factory that's converted over into different kind of businesses. And these are all buzzing with life. And you start to see these kind of like, even if this was let go right now and no one did anything, a lot of these plants would reseed. You've got sunflowers here. You would have other weeds would come in. They've already affected the landscape here, that you would actually have a natural ecosystem start to occur. And eventually, it would probably become self-sustaining in its own way. I mean, admittedly, a lot of forgotten allotments downtown, they might just get to say things like Tree of Heaven, Box Elder, Cottonwood, Purslane. You know, you might get a couple of random other things like chicory and stuff like that. But that in itself is still a variety of different species that other species can actually feed on and actually has its kind of own merit in itself. But even this is great because like, people are planting plants they want. They need bees, they need pollinators. The plant actually has, on its roof, it has a beehives. And all these bees are coming down to this area to pollinate the plants here as well, which is pretty exciting as well. So it's just an example of how people are really starting to use their urban environment to do these different things. And green roofs have taken off a little bit in the last few years and been in the news quite a bit. But this is all happening as well, which I think is exciting. This is, my colleague actually took a picture of this. This is just down from her house. She lives in Logan Square area. And this is on the parkway in her neighborhood. And someone planted at the parkway, which is technically city property anyway, where we've got things like Cosmos and Erangeum over here, and Coreopsis, and fennel, and all variety of, I don't know what's going on here. I don't know what the plan is, but it's amazing, nevertheless, that all this life is actually existing kind of in our streets now, and in areas that you probably would never have had this before as well, because someone planted it, put new things in, and wanted to attract butterflies. This is like a full pollinator garden, but not using anything but just cool stuff, which I think is really fascinating that people are now doing this as well. At my house, I have, on my parkway, I planted a variety of native plants. I don't plant vegetables because, quite frankly, I don't want to have my dog pee on plants I want to eat. But for everyone else, it's great. So I'm quite happy to actually start converting areas into kind of natural spaces. And the parkway, you know, we're so lawn obsessed, but if you actually let it go a little bit, clear some of the stuff up, put some native plants in, you start attracting so much more wildlife, and it's really fascinating. The air becomes alive. What's really neat, though, is the actual, as I mentioned earlier, the actual active restoration things that are going on in our park districts. Different municipalities are doing, but also Chicago is doing. This is the Laurie Garden downtown, in Grand Park. And this is rattlesnake master. This is compass plant. You know, we've got a couple of cool things going on here. And this is full of life. The fact that, that people are using native plants in a way that is ornamental and beautiful at the same time as well, I think is a great thing. And it, it creates so much more habitat, and it's a wonderful place for people to actually go to as well. But also, further down, the Burnham Restoration Project that they do, it's basically a book, it's a long trip. You wouldn't believe that this is, again, in an urban area. Apart from the building in the background and a couple of light posts, this is amazing what people are actually doing. And they actually created these mounds to kind of make them a bit more moraine-like, so that basically means you get some different species is going, as well going on. The, that active work. And if you go down these areas, you can see these swarms of dragonflies feeding over these areas, which means it's full of life because the dragonflies are there because there's so much more life. Some people are saying, why the dragonfly numbers have been increasing? And I think it's partly because there's more food, because we've created more habitat for other insects, for other things to feed on. And more dragonflies also means more food for birds. It just has a knock-on benefit of creating a lot of cool things. It also helps reduce, you know, the roots are so deep on these native plants, it helps reduce runoff. It means we're not going to have so much storm surges, or not storm surges, but surges in our systems, which is also a good benefit as well.
So where is that?
This is also in the Burnham thing. So basically, if you take the bike path from about 47th Street up to like 32nd Street, that whole area is like a strip. And it's on either side. You can go exploring in amongst it. And like I said, they've got some artwork there. It's a really nice place to go. So what I like to do is I like to park on Hyde Park Boulevard around like 51st Street. Get on my bike. I might go up back and forth and then explore the areas. And it's never as busy as the north side. It's busy enough we don't feel like it's like dangerous or anything, but it's not as busy as the north side, which is nice. But it's beautiful. We also have, like, these are like people, the Cook County Forest Preserve, the DuPage Forest Preserve, Will County Forest Preserve, they're all working. I think this is Bartow Grassland right here. And this is like near Camp Sagawatt as well. People are converting these large, Bartow's a little bit larger, but like these large grasslands. They're mostly Eurasian species, but they're actually really starting to convert a lot of the species into more native structure. And even though some of these grasslands may not be fully native, and they probably never will be fully native, they have the structure and they start to act like a big grassland, which is what is important about it as well. Olive grassland is also another case of a big grassland which one can visit. And you get all these things like bobolink birds there. You get different types of sparrow, henslow sparrow, and things of this nature, and these large, wonderful grassland species. And they're all very worthwhile kinds to go and explore, because you can see they actually, I think, there's a type of owl that goes there in January and February, and I can't forget, remember, fiery eyes. Anyway, you can see different species at different times of year as well, so that's actually what's really exciting about these large periods. And these are all managed by the Forest Preserve districts, which is really exciting, that they've actually really started. I remember when I first came here, again, it's not that long ago, but 16 years, there was this whole idea that we shouldn't do burns. But burns are so integral to these kind of landscapes. And again, burning is such a human thing to do. We're modifying the landscape, but arguably this landscape was modified in the first place by native peoples anyway, by burning areas to create grasslands, to create more fodder for bison. But if you have 10,000 years of that, you've created an ecosystem where humans have impacted the environment and created the environment. So these places are great to explore. This area is quite close to us. This is a little hillside, actually, at Lake Catherine. If you go down the Eastern Trails, if you go between Harlem and Richmond, there's an open area on the right-hand side. And we've been converting it over the last few years to actually turn this into more of a prairie species. Now, most of those hillsides on either side of the Cow Sac, which Lake Catherine is most of, that was put there when they dug the Cow Sac. They dug everything out, they put it on the side, this is back in 1911, 1922, and originally a whole lot of invasive and weedier species kind of came in. So the soil here is awful, it's terrible, it's just rock and shale. So it's always such a human impact in the environment. This is what you can get when you start affecting the human environment. And you see a lot of those little things that we're trying to do at Lake Catherine, where we're trying to improve the biodiversity. No, we're never going to be a super high quality site, but trying to improve the quality, trying to reduce the number of invasive species, not necessarily getting rid of all species, but trying to reduce the more key ones, and then trying to introduce things that are beneficial as well. But you've also got, the Forest Preserve has so many different types of woodlands out there as well. This is over at Camp Sagawatt as well. You have the savanna area. This tree is probably only about 100 or so years old. So this obviously, I think a lot of this area really wasn't as well planted up, or they were deforested pretty heavily. And a lot of this is secondary growth. It's not that much old growth that was actually here. There was in the time when the first settlers came here, but they suddenly kind of denuded the woodlands pretty quickly. And the moraines and the hills were actually, and along the riverbanks would be where you would find the savannas and the forests, because that's the natural fire breaks where you'd actually have them. So putting those trees back into those areas is a natural place for those trees to actually be. But again, this is a human-infected landscape. This is this has to be managed by humans. This has to be changed because they can't operate otherwise, because the invasive species would take this over. This would all be buckthorn and honeysuckle if it was left to its own devices. So we have to affect the landscape if we want it to be healthier. So it brings me to this term of novel ecosystems. And it's basically, some people don't like the idea of novel ecosystems, but I think it has a role to play. There are some areas that you want to conserve as is, and you want to be absolutely diligent in trying to remove any kind of non-native species. Absolutely. There are some places you don't have to do that. And novel ecosystems kind of play into that. They have a role to play because if you took them out, they probably would reduce the biodiversity because they'd be so affected by humans over the time. They have merit in their own lights. They basically, and also if you took humans away, they'd almost be self-governing in their own way. They actually create their own ecosystems. So that's the term novel ecosystems. And you can actually use these kind of areas. They occur all around the world. Some parts of Hawaii has been affected by invasive species massively. But most of Hawaii's gardens and like some of the natural areas that aren't pristine are probably made up of a variety of different tropical species from around the world. But if you were to completely eradicate all those species in that area, you probably would be, the biodiversity would decrease. And so that's what a novel ecosystem actually is. And it's kind of self-maintaining to a certain extent. Some areas don't do that, and you have to manage them, or you have to keep them pristine, but not all of them. This area, I like this because you've got this rocky outcrop right here, and I kind of think this is one. You've got box elder here, you have some milkweed here, you have some bone set here. You basically have concrete that's turned into sand right here. You basically got a sandy, kind of rocky substrate, but it's all concrete based because of what it was put there before. But these plants have found a way. They've adapted to the environment, and they're actually doing okay. And if you took all these plants out because you wanted to put, say, turf grass in, you'd actually reduce the merit of this area right now. You wouldn't have the milkweed, so you wouldn't have some colorful butterflies. You wouldn't have the bone set, which is a native plant. You wouldn't have all the grasshoppers. You wouldn't. Some people have done these side-by-side analyses where you have turf grass going onto unmown field. And on the turf grass, there's no sound. It's basically dead. Just one species. And then on everything else, it's just full of life. And I think that's the kind of the point about it as well. Like sometimes letting some areas go is okay. There's also one of the things I also like to think about, because of the Chicago's merit, is creating and improving our quality of our biodiversity in areas creates these things called metapopulations. And basically what you do is you've got these islands of nature that are kind of connected to each other. And they start to operate as a whole because you have a genetic transfer, basically one animal's going to another place because they're closer to each other, and there's genetic transfer there. So Chicago has the opportunity and has been doing a lot of that, where you're having all these little different pockets of natural areas and forgotten areas where they're actually having species go from one to another. Maybe it's arthropods, maybe it's birds, maybe it's mammals even. I mean, we just talked about coyotes. But they're all kind of not interbreeding anymore. If they were just in here, you'd have a very poor population that can have things cause problems. So creating all these different habitats is very beneficial, even from a migratory standpoint. Even better is that when we start planning for this, if we start using, say, our corridors, maybe our boulevards and our park districts, and create more of these natural areas, you create these lovely kind of connectivities between areas. And so you start getting high connectivity, you increase your health of your populations that you actually do have, because they can go from one place to another. And especially with change occurring with climate and everything, you're probably going to need more of these connections to allow populations to naturally adjust if they so can. So I think that's really important to kind of end off, is that there's a scientific benefit to having these little areas. There's also an ecological benefit and a biodiverse benefit to having all these lovely little natural areas around Chicago. And I thought this was kind of a nice thing. I kind of like Shelley. You know, everything is mingled, everything should connect. Everything in law is a vibe, and I kind of like that. I usually quote the Aussie Manius one, which is a bit more, kind of less chipper, I guess. But I like this. And then the other thing I thought, you know, nature is out there. It's in your back door. It's everywhere. I mean, this is a mantid. I mean, this is not a native mantid, but this is everywhere. So you can actually find these creatures in your back door. And I think the point about it is, with Chicago, we kind of think we have to go off to, say, Yellowstone. Yellowstone's amazing. Don't get me wrong. I love it. But we've also got these amazing nucleuses of areas, and some of it really is next door. Some of it is really just outside your window. Some of it's at the back of the parking lot that maybe is where an oldie is or something like that because they let some grass grow. Maybe it's along a train line and it's full of life, and there's like raptors, there's snakes, there's all these other kind of things, there's mantids, and it's all cool, and I think it's worthwhile to like realize that nature is right there sometimes, and that we can make a benefit to it as well and improve the quality of it as well when we can. So, and that's about it.
Any questions or?
I wonder, are the deer disappearing in our forest preserves? I live right across the street from one, and I used to see them all the time, and they'd come in the yard, you know.
Well, sometimes the deer populations will go naturally up and down as well. But I think the forest preserves at one point a few years ago was trying to do something other than culling.
Yeah.
But they were doing culling at one point.
Oh, really?
But bear in mind is natural populations of prey will actually go up and down, especially if you have disease. Especially that's one of the problems that we've been talking about with deer as well. If you have large numbers of a certain species, the deer populations at one point were higher than they were pre-settlement here. That means that if you have a disease, it can actually have an impact on the populations very, very quickly. It still means that it probably will rebound at some point, but that's one of the problems with having such a high number of deer. I don't know the answer specifically to your question, but there's a variety of things that could have affected it.